The idea for this talk and for much of my book was that I wanted to rethink the way we talked about Mark Twain and children. I mean, it's been taken for granted that he's one of the great, you know, writers, if not the great American writer about children, but we've always talked about a certain kind of childhood, and I'm not sure if it was really the kind of childhood he was seeing around him, and that's the book that I wrote. And the inspiration for this talk actually comes from Quarry Farm, which I've never visited until 2 days ago, and I was delighted to see that it kind of matched up. The title for this talk comes from a short anecdote Sam Clemens tells about a July evening in 1884 at Quarry Farm that he spent with his daughter Jean, not yet 4 years old, watching some cows in the pasture. The hour is getting late, and the father thinks they should be getting back home, but the daughter wants to follow the cows as they wander off in the opposite direction. They debate in both English and German until the daughter, in German, says, "We won't talk any more about it," over and over until she finally wins. He ought to have spanked her, Clemens tells us, but he was charmed instead and decided he would fraternize with the enemy and spend another half hour watching the cows as the sun went down. It's a typical Mark Twain anecdote about childhood and about family, the lightness, the sentimentality, the adult surrender to the child, and that odd and charming surprise at the end, that strange appearance of the German language in the mouth of the three-year-old girl mid-tantrum. It's a shame, as is often the case with Twain, to apply some heavy-handed analytical apparatus to such a light story. And yet, that's exactly what I'm going to do for the next 30 minutes or so. Because in other venues, other places, Twain was at that time wrestling with the question of that spanking he ought to apply but wouldn't, the question not just of corporal punishment, itself a driving national debate at the time, but of how much control adults should have over the lives of children in general through a variety of institutions, most notably church and school. In his own journals, he was blurry on the issue, bragging about the positive effects a steady spanking had on his oldest daughter, Susie, for instance, when she took a turn towards lying, yet admitting years later that he was himself lying, and that a gentle reminder from Charles Darwin, of all people, to simply ignore the lies worked much better than the spanking ever did. And then back to Jean, again, back to Quarry Farm. In May of the previous year, he had tried to spank her one time. She wouldn't say please, and so he dragged her off to the bathroom and spanked her with a belt, and she still wouldn't say please. "Jean won't," she said, and 1 month later, when she saw a mouse gnawing at the cupboard, she told the mouse to run away before her daddy took him into the bathroom and spanked him and made him say please. And that was all the daddy could handle. That same year, he wrote a scene where one of his true heroes, Jim the escaping slave, admits to Huck Finn that he had beaten his daughter for not responding politely to him, only to discover that she was deaf from scarlet fever and thus incapable of responding. "He'll never forgive himself," Jim says over and over, and while the timing is a little too vague to nail down, it's still hard to resist the notion that the father, who realized that such abuse doesn't work, was the one holding the pen, not the one on the other end of it. To return to that initial anecdote then, it's those key words, both fraternize and enemy, that tell us so much about Twain's vision of the relations between children and adults, both in terms of the conflicts created and then subverted. He saw relations between children and adults as a conflict, even a kind of civil rights struggle. He wasn't sure which side he was on, but he did see sides. Given the option and a moment of reflection, he would not use force, but he would fraternize, not patronize, not indulge, not tolerate like a loving or docile parent might, but he would place himself alongside the child. He would see this as dangerous, as a kind of traitorship to that middle-class audience he both mocked and relied upon, but he'd do it. And more than that, he would, from time to time, see all this as overlapping with other kinds of fraternizing with the enemy, other topographies of American enemies created and American trader ships established. That is, for all the talk about children in Mark Twain, which generally takes place over here, and for all the talk about race in Mark Twain, which generally takes place over there, there has been little talk about the intersection, where the conversations might share some cultural DNA, and where the enemies and the fraternizing mix, triangulate, and blur into something even more amazing. All of this leads me, inevitably, to discussion of that most famous book of his, the one most inextricably linked to the topic of Twain and children, and Twain and race, and hopefully allows me to offer at least a mildly different way of looking at a book that has generated so much scholarship and so much debate, to rethink its revolutionary power and where its true breakthroughs lay by connecting the dots in the opposite direction from the direction we've usually used. Water, give me a sec. You still can't hear? I'm sorry. I'll put the microphone closer. How's that? Is that any better? Yes? To talk about Twain and children, of course, would take hours, even days, and I'm going to stick to this 30-minute limit I offered before. So let me offer you at least a brisk flyover of the really interesting literary biography such a focus offers, one in which Huck Finn stands chronologically, thematically, aesthetically, and politically right smack in the middle. Let's start with Twain's own childhood, but leave aside the content of that well-told tale, except to point out an obvious, if understated, point. The man had an amazing, amazing memory. And in a structural sense, that the deep imprint of that youth, its joys and its traumas, remained so unrepressed for much of his adulthood, might alone explain his lifelong commitment to the matter of the lives of children. He just remembered better than we do. It wouldn't show up that way at first, of course, any more than his early writings make the case that the author-to-be might become a potent anti-racist and anti-imperialist. There's a letter back home to his mother from New York when he was 17, for instance, complaining about the brats and trundle bed trash, children I mean, that he was passing in the streets. This was, of course, not an auspicious start to the writing career of an author whose most famous character was a homeless child, but what matters, as always, is the journey. There are the counter-sentimental satires of the 1860s, brash and violent, in which the children are the object of the satire, gentle or not, there to be dismembered or dismember each other. Advice to the mother or father of a child with a stammer, for instance, to remove the underjaw, or the sister of a brattish brother to not correct him with mud when it was better to scald him a little. And then there was a subtle shift where slowly but clearly, over the course of less than a decade, the object of the satire becomes less the children than the adult institutions designed to keep children in line. A lively synthesis where he throws his scattershot in every direction. The story of the good little boy who did not prosper, for instance, who always obeyed his parents, no matter how absurd and unreasonable their demands were, and whose reward for such fidelity to authority is being blown to bits like a Warner Brothers cartoon character, the result of some leftover nitroglycerin and almost too perfectly a misplaced act of corporal punishment. And then there was another shift where unequivocally the object of satire becomes the pedagogy itself, a really wonderful tack where Twain dismantled many of the most famous role models that a mid-Victorian boy or girl was expected to emulate. Ben Franklin, George Washington, and even in one fairly obscure piece, Jesus Christ himself, whom Twain portrayed as a boy who kills the schoolmaster who tries to whip him for failing to tell his letters properly. All of this would lead to the roughly two-decade period in which children were Twain's great subject, from the 1870s to the 1890s, a period that would start with Tom Sawyer and end with Joan of Arc and shuttle from antebellum Hannibal to medieval Europe. And along the way, the children who had started his career getting blown up began handling the explosives, and not just the play wars of a Tom Sawyer either. There were the child soldiers of the Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court from 1889, not long after Huck Finn, the 52 teenage boys Hank Morgan recruits to help him annihilate an army of 30,000 medieval knights. Let's not forget that Hank Morgan, among his many endeavors, was an educational reformer, building a system of hidden schools throughout England. One suspects Twain would have liked to do that too. Or the most famous child soldier of all time, Joan of Arc, the subject of the history disguised as memoir Twain published in 1896. She was, in real life, the revolutionary that Tom Sawyer was always dreaming he was. And she was a woman, too, an interesting and important moment that suggested that Twain was not just thinking about boys as much as popular conception seems to think he was. And by the last decade of Twain's life, he remains something more than merely sentimental about children. Among the very last things he wrote from Bermuda in 1910 was a psychological portrait of a 16-year-old girl named Helen Allen, in which he passionately blamed her parents for the outbursts of anger for which the teen was criticized, for which teens are always being criticized, saying, quote, "No parent has a right to insult a child. No parent can do it and not damage the child." Later, in a letter he wrote to Helen herself, one of the last things he ever wrote, filled with crossouts and possibly never sent, he told her to be cautious, watchful, wary, a warning about her boyfriend, maybe, or about her parents, maybe, or about the adult world at large, which he both represented and rejected. In other words, his feelings towards children ran a very large range over a very long life. In fun, and sometimes not in fun, as their ally and sometimes their enemy, in irony and sometimes not, deep in sentimentality and sometimes not, he looked at children as through a kaleidoscope. The only common theme, truthfully, was that he never really saw them as anything but independent actors, whether or not the society at large saw them as such. And turning now to Huck Finn, at no point in his career did he twist that kaleidoscope as much or with as much passion as he did in that great book. You can't say the topic of childhood and Huck Finn is something new, of course. That's one of the most ridiculous things one could possibly ever say. For over 100 years, Huck Finn was arguably the book for children, and Huck was America's child. It sold tens of millions of copies and was the most often taught book in American schools for the latter half of the 20th century. It was translated into movies, into TV and radio plays, each starring an iconic boy actor, Jackie Cooper, Mickey Rooney, Elijah Wood. It was adapted into numerous abridged editions and cartoon after cartoon all over the world. And references to a Huck Finn childhood still appear on editorial pages and in the advertisements for summer camps and bluegrass retreats. It is invariably an innocent childhood, an outdoor childhood, free from school and free from grown-ups, and as such, largely resistant to grown-up interpretation. At the same time, the idea that Huck Finn might be something more, a serious book, an important book, a classic, did take hold. That discussion simply avoided the issue of children. As critics and biographers praised Huck as a stylistic and moral masterpiece, they also said that Mark Twain had arrested development. His ability to transcend meaningless conventions when speaking with children, celebrated in his day, was defined after his day as a tragic mistake. And similarly, as the book became a civic artifact, celebrated by politicians everywhere, and then reconstituted as a site of controversy, the book's conflicted vision of race occupied the foreground of almost every discussion. That there might be a politically interesting book about children, or that the controversial book about race and the innocent one about children might actually be the same book, was a marginal consideration. To claim that Huck Finn is a serious book about childhood, then, a book as ambitious about childhood as it is about other things, at least, does not exactly require a big discovery. In fact, the prevalence of the idea that Huck Finn was a celebration of innocent childhood should have told us that was exactly the place to go look for buried treasure. It's like a big X in the ground. Drifting amid the corpses, 13 by most people's counts, the suicidal ideation, as a general thing, Huck tells us, it makes a body wish he was dead. The child abuse, I used to be scared of him all the time, Huck says of his pap, he tamed me so much. The deadly dull schools and churches, as well as the genuine humor and the deep, deep empathy. We should have guessed long ago that Huck Finn was no simple portrait of American childhood. Over the past two decades, however, there have been several shifts in intellectual sentiment and in resources that have reshaped how Huck Finn's approach to childhood can be regarded. The University of California Press has done a happy job issuing unpublished Twain autobiographical materials, which among the many treasures they provide, do also provide our best ever portrait of a curious father observing his children in a way that would inevitably overlap with his own creative writing. And trends in the field of young adult fiction have also gone a long way to blurring the false boundary between children's and adult fiction that lasted a century, but didn't really exist in the time Twain was writing. Lastly, and perhaps most significantly, the field of childhood studies has introduced us, with some scholarly discipline, to the notion that youth is a cultural construction as much as race and gender. An even bolder notion that the rhetorics of racism and sexism are irretrievably linked to those surrounding the treatment of children and may never be fully pulled out by their roots until they are all pulled out by their roots. In this discussion, Huck's moment, the mid-Victorian era, was a watershed where modern views on parenting came into focus, and Huck, far from living an ideal model childhood, was experiencing the kinds of distress that modern social scientists regard as the markers of abused children, the children of alcoholics, even children likely to have criminal adulthoods and go to jail. Altogether, these developments bring our time and Twain's closer. They make legible a personal and public history set in the Victorian era, not the antebellum, the time he was writing, not the time he was writing about, where an inventive author might write something designed to reach both children and their parents in deep and rich ways. Twain did draw wonderfully upon his past, but the notion that was all he did became so canonical that it obscured the fact that he was also thinking about children in non-nostalgic terms. He was thinking about children of his own time. He was thinking of his own children, and he was creating something genuinely new in the history of childhood and literature. What, then, might a reading of Huck Finn attuned to these concerns look and feel like? One might start with the thing hiding in plain sight, that amid all the creative impulses that inspired Huck Finn, what Twain wanted most of all was to simply bring a real child's voice to life. He told William Dean Howells this that summer in 1876 when he began writing, that his main regret about Tom Sawyer was that it wasn't in first person. He'd fix that. As well, Twain devoted much of A Record of the Small Foolishnesses of Susie and Bay Clemens' Infants, composed perfectly, intriguingly, remarkably, over almost the exact same time span he wrote Huck Finn, 1876 to 1884, to a record of his three daughters, Susie, Clara, and Jean. And Twain just didn't find their language cute or adorable. Instead, he described their literally childish variants of standard English as self-aware, even possessing what he called discriminating exactness. It's the same bedrock belief in the conscious artistry of a child's voice that would make Huck Finn possible. He thought his own children were artists and writers already, and he made sure Huck Finn was too. As importantly, Twain's affinity in Huck Finn for a child's voice overlapped with his affinity for a child's perspective, which he intuitively felt was undervalued. Much has been written about the relationship between Huck Finn and slavery, the failure of Reconstruction, and the rise of Jim Crow. The degree and clarity of Twain's commitment on race remains a vital topic for anyone who loves or hates the book. At the same time, a quick review of newspapers in Twain's era reveals that the issue of childhood occupied almost as many front pages as did race matters. Child mortality, labor, homelessness, and illiteracy were the flashpoints of reform debates alongside those being constructed around civil rights for African Americans. And these articles ran side by side, column by column, all over the East, South, and Midwest, blurring the two discourses in the most remarkable ways. That children were not well heard in the nation's capitals, and that the literature addressed to children was sanctimonious and echoed adult interests only, were driving, if ironic, inspirations for many of Twain's essays in the 1860s and 1870s, including some that brilliantly addressed racial concerns too, like his 1870 satire on anti-Chinese bias, The Disgraceful Persecution of a Boy, which we can now see in retrospect, as only the first time Twain attacked structural racism while defending the perspective of a child whose main crime was that the newspapers, police, and politicians of his time instructed him, taught him to hate someone of another color. That said, Huck Finn was still new for him. Rather than acting as ambassador, as he once called himself, between adults and children, he gave up the pen to the child. And in so doing, he expanded his own artistic and political ambitions. Start with those opening words, "You don't know about me." First five words of Huck Finn. Reading the entire opening sentence at normal reading speed, this lead phrase might be missed, its challenge to the reader, implicitly an adult, blunted. But "you don't know about me" is a challenge. The Adventures of Tom Sawyer started with a similar call out. Aunt Polly can't find Tom while wearing her state pair, the glasses she wears for style, and which can't be looked through to locate something as small as a boy. The same impulse inspires both books, a belief that children are waiting to be discovered, but that our favorite lenses are inadequate to the task of really, really seeing them. From that point forward, the first pages of Huck Finn unfold remarkably. Twain's efforts are restless, as always, but there are many, many passages where he adopts a child's sensibility with extraordinary results. Note, for instance, the scene in chapter one where Huck is scolded for being fidgety, a scene cited by modern scientists like David Nyland, comparing Huck's restlessness to that found in present-day children diagnosed with ADD. Miss Watson would say, "Put your feet up there, Huckleberry, and don't scrunch up like that, Huckleberry, set up straight." We are placed so thoroughly within Huck's perspective that we don't see the fidgeting that creates the scolding. It's as normal to us as it is to him. And as a result, the scolding of the adult seems as arbitrary to us as it does to him. These moments, these spaces are everywhere. When Huck sees Bog shot by Colonel Sherburne in chapter 21 and scrambles to get a good place by the window to watch him die, Huck does not explain his complicated relationship with voyeurism and violence. It too is normal for him, as normal to him as my son's engagement with the violence of Super Smash Brothers is to him. It is these gaps, the creation of a child's perspective through the absence of signifiers, the absence of hints, those absences in turn providing a detailed roadmap of the alienation between children and adults, that makes a serious reading of Huck Finn on youth as sometimes hard to find, as a serious reading of Huck Finn on race proved for earlier generations. In fact, a fresh reading of Huck Finn tuned to youth would pause often where most readings do not now pause, at the way Huck feels like I would die when Mary Jane Wilkes places her hand over his, for instance, or oppositely Tom's weird shaming of Aunt Sally, kissing her on the lips and saying that everybody told him to. On the way Huck intuitively equates institutions like school to physical child abuse. And contrarily, such a reading would also pause where Twain calls out to parents. When an adult casually contemplates an empathic approach to children, for instance, or sees, rightly, conspiracy in youthful efforts to overturn the grown-up world. "So it was you," Aunt Sally explains to Huck and Tom at novel's end, a vastly undervalued line, "you've been the ones making all the trouble." In addition, familiarity with the history of childhood reveals a satire on child rearing as sharp and relevant as familiarity with Reconstruction is found on race relations. As Mark Twain composed Huck Finn, the idea of childhood in America was undergoing a significant transformation. On a variety of stages, childhood was becoming standardized and professionalized. This was the age when the idea of a pediatrician became a commonplace, when shared spaces like public parks altered the faces of cities and towns, when compulsory education laws were approved nationwide, and when legislators, for the first time, argued over funding a federal education system that would reach children of all races, religions, and classes. Simultaneously, this was also when certain anxieties about children entered the foreground of American life. We think we are the first generation that has raised children obsessed with violent popular culture. We think we're the first generation to witness children as agents of violence themselves. But the Victorians were inured to stories of children committing crimes inspired by popular dime novels. Newspapers printed jailhouse interviews from teenage killers routinely. Victorian academics argued that a period of wildness was a normal part of growing up. But newspapers cried about a bad boy crisis on the one hand and lamented on the other that those children in those new standardized schools were losing touch with nature, with their own families, and with some ineffable innocence that marked the childhood of earlier generations. In turn, Huck Finn reverberated wildly in these Victorian debates, a fact largely lost on modern readers who don't know about them. Tobacco, for instance, was considered a huge threat to the health and morals of American children, like drugs are now. Twain, wasting no time whatsoever, makes Huck a defiant and proud spoker on the book's third page. And truancy was considered the most punishable of teenage sins, and Huck, too, makes his preference clear on that topic in the very first chapter. That said, the newspapers such as the New York World that dismissed Huck as Mark Twain's bad boy missed half the point. Huck is also attuned to nature and resists the one major character in the book, Tom Sawyer, of course, who can't tell the difference between real life and pop life. Half the time, Huck is the kind of child for whom compulsory education laws were passed and work farms and juvies built. And half the time, he's the standard that educational reformers, then and now, aspire to have all children meet. In this contradiction, of course, lies Twain's brilliance, in his refusal to vote a straight ticket, as he often said of himself. Huck Finn was not intended to placate any single agenda on how to raise children. And Twain himself was deeply torn. He respected his wife Olivia's well-organized child-rearing style, for instance, but he undermined it routinely. "Mama loves morals," Susie reportedly said. "Papa loves cats." And when expected to practice discipline himself, corporal punishment in particular, he was mortified and put down the stick. Huck Finn fully recognizes the dualism implied in the words "fraternizing with the enemy." Children and parents were enemies in some generational conflict, but to Twain, that conflict was as false as that between black and white and as uneven. For Twain, the gains Victorians made in the humane treatment of children, which shape our consensus today, were marred by the paternalistic philosophy that treated children like little adults to be molded alike into the same mass-produced shapes. As such, longstanding efforts to universalize Huck Finn as America's child miss some of the beauty of Twain's nonconforming vision. All American childhoods were not and are not alike, then or now. On the semi-autobiographical level, Huck Finn was based not on African American children from the South, for instance, nor laboring immigrant children in the cities, nor middle-class children in those newly organized public schools. He was based on the frontier children of the mid-19th century, whom European observers saw as nomadic, profane, and numb to violence, carrying guns and playing poker with grown-ups in the bars. Simultaneously, however, Twain was channeling his own children, homeschooled in Europe and in New England, surrounded by family and servants, a most un-Huck Finn-like upbringing, seemingly. Line up small foolishnesses about his own children alongside Huck Finn, read them side by side, as it appears Twain wrote them side by side, and the echoes are unmistakable. Repeatedly, Twain marks Clara and Susie's dark humor, their bluesiness. "Mama, what's it all for?" Susie asks in several variants. These traits emerge in Huck's voice too, especially when his loneliness and dissonant spirituality rise to the book's surface, as they do often. Twain even admires Clara's use of the adjective lonesome to describe a baby's cry. He'll have Huck meditate upon the right sound to call lonesome as well. In fact, reading Small Foolishnesses alongside Huck Finn, one sees how clearly Twain viewed unconventional religiosity and idiosyncratic self-expression as the signs of a healthy child. The extent to which a child defied being standardized, that was his test. Just as Susie spends much of Small Foolishnesses finding her own way to talk to God, finally telling Olivia that, "You would not approve of the way I pray now, Mama," so too does Huck's moral development famously peak when he ironically asks God for the courage to turn in Jim and discovers instead that you can't pray a lie. And just as Huck chooses truancy over school, Susie and Clara teach themselves to read English incredibly against the wishes of their parents. That Twain raved about their independence in so doing, nobody has given her an instant's assistance, he celebrated proudly. Tells us just how strongly he believed that child rearing was a complex, sometimes passive, and often shapeless act. This is the one anecdote I can never get over. The father who forbids his kids from learning how to read, who keeps the books away from them and then celebrates when they steal the books and read them anyway. That really tells you everything I think you need to know about what he thought about organized education. Seen through this prism, in fact, many of the flaws conventionally ascribed to Huck Finn take on new light. They reflect efforts to give form to this formless vision of childhood. Twain wrote in a family sketch that children grew up haphazardly. "Mama, or the school, or the pulpit," he said, "might get the credit if it be of a creditable nature." But he added that countless outside unconscious and unintentional trainers do the real work. And he wrote Huck Finn just like this, like a coming-of-age novel whose very form reflected not the false linearity of conventional views of parenting, but this excited, atomized vision of how children really grow up. In this context, the book's bad plot is the point. It demonstrates how a child raises himself via contrast and context that flirt just beneath the surface and rarely make themselves available in the book or in real life for analysis and reproduction. That Miss Watson refused to let him smoke, but herself takes snuff galls Huck. "That was all right," he sneers, because she'd done it herself. And signals to him that she might be a hypocrite in other ways, like respecting family in the abstract, but planning to sell Jim away from his wife and daughter. Likewise, as Myra Jalen has observed, Huck appears to take Judith Loftus's lessons about how the difference between a boy and a girl is a matter of how you throw, or how you thread a needle, that is, all performance, and apply it to his relationship with Jim. Such a reading has been used to illustrate Twain's intersectional vision. What applies to gender applies to race. They're both fake. But such a vision also aligns with what some modern educational theorists describe as the dynamic, unpredictable reality of children and growth. We all learn by accident, but we learn. Similarly, the closing section of the book, the evasion, has been excoriated for decades by those who believe that Twain subverts the moral arc on race he created in earlier chapters. Having vowed to free Jim or go to hell in chapter 31, the book's high point in many readings, Huck does not prevent Tom Sawyer from turning Jim's escape into a burlesque where the slave is entrapped by a white boy's fantasy. A fresh reading of that section, however, might acknowledge its many pages devoted to the destruction of a middle-class slave-holding household by children, twinned with its critique of corporal punishment. Aunt Sally, for instance, sluicing out coffee with one hand and cracking the handiest child's head with the other. The debate on race in those closing sections doesn't fade by recognizing this material on youth. It's illuminated by it. A story about the failure of American adults to raise their children humanely and wisely is being told inextricably from a second story about endemic and cyclical racism. It is not that one story is serious and one is innocent. It is the shared and complicated outrage we should feel about both that matters. In fact, the achievement of Huck Finn is that it offers us the opportunity to see where our child-rearing practices interact with our national politics, a conversation we rarely ever have, and one we defy having by maintaining that Huck Finn was a lighthearted book about children and a deep book about other things. It is the same Twain who flirts with race-blind structures, Huck and Jim Free and Easy on the Raft, for instance, that flirts with a holistic vision of childhood as a fluid, do-it-yourself place. And it's the same Twain who displaces Jim from that raft into the pseudo-slavery of Tom's fantasies that also morosely recognizes the likelihood that official institutions will tightly control childhood, whether or not they have earned the right to do so. When Huck says he will light out for the territory rather than be civilized at the end of the book, he means many, many things. But he means first and foremost that an older generation can't teach him a damn thing. It is a line written by a parent to other parents, and it is meant to sting. Thank you.